Welcome to another informative series brought to you by Autruo. In today's series, we will be looking at bottle washing technology. The intricate parts that made up this machine will be discussed in detail and coupled with practical examples. Stay tuned.
Hi bro. What are you up to today?
Nothing much. Just doing some housekeeping.
I see. Don't tell me you are arranging those bottles. It will be better off disposed.
Yeah. I am arranging them before the dispatch rider will come to pick them.
I see. So you mean that the bottle can still be used?
Yes. After retriever, there is a machine that does the cleaning before it will undergoes filling process again.
Interesting. Can you share some light on this? I think I can learn something new today, because there is a lot of thing that comes into play here.
Okay, a moment. Let me set up a space there. Those bottles you saw earlier are called RGB. Which means returnable glass bottles. These bottles are retrieved after usage. Again, certain conditions must be met. That is, it must not be weather, broken, cracked, and chipped. The retrieved bottles will be loaded into the machine. This machine is called bottle washer. What this machine does is to clean and remove dirt from the bottles. The cleaning is achieved through the use of hot caustic and fresh water. After cleaning, the bottles are usually inspected by a quality personnel. The quality personnel check for cracks, caustic carryover, and chip necks. They also check for label carryover, which is to check if the label was properly removed. All these checks are carried out at random at the discharge of the machine. Now let's look at how the machine works. At infeed, bottles will be transferred to the pub of the carrier. The transferred bottles will be moved by the carriers from one cleaning zones to another until the bottles come out at the discharge of the machine. Bottle washer are divided into various zones. These zones are jetting, pre-soak, caustic, and post-treatment zone. Now let's look at what happens in each zone. At the jetting zone, the water jet out at high pressure, and the jet water moves along with the bottles. These movement of the jetting bar is achieved through a protruding rod attached to the carrier as the chains move the carriers. The protruding rods also move the jetting bars. These movements ensure that the jetting bar is in sync with the carriers and all the difficult angles are cleaned. Again, one thing worth noting is that the jetting bar, also known as spray bar, are placed at multiple locations within the machine as per design. After dirt and soiling within the bottles have been removed, which is achieved as a result of the high jetting water pressure, the chain will move the carrier to a water tank, which is known as the bottle pre-soak zone.
So, dirt, soils, and other foreign materials are removed as a result of this processes. So if I may ask, what is going to happen to the dirty particles removed? Is it that they will be allowed to decay, or is there any special process that happens afterward?
No. By design. Machine designer usually put mats just below the carrier. So basically, instead of the labels and other foreign material to fall off to the tank below, the mats will be used to collect the dirt and move them out outwards. The next zone is pre-soak. The bottles will be dipped in water solution. The aim of this is to soften the labels and to further clean the bottles. Now that the labels are wet and are also soft. Again, the pre-soak zone also consists of a mixture of caustic and water. Because by design, caustic are allowed to follow to the pre-soak tank by gravity. Now the bottles will be transferred to the caustic zone. It is at this tank that the bottle will undergo a thorough cleaning activities. Now, in order for the label to be thoroughly removed from the bottles and also in order to have a clean bottle, the caustic solution will be agitated. This will ensure that the bottles are well clean, and as a result of the agitated caustic solutions, labels are removed as well. From these caustic baths, it will be moved to another bath. The agitation process also happens. Again, the number of baths also depends on the design of the machine. From the final caustic baths, the next zone is the post-caustic zones, also known as post-treatment. Here the bottles will be dipped in a freshwater tank that has constant running of freshwater. This ensures that the bottles are well cleaned with fresh water. After coming out of the freshwater tank, the bottles will be flushed with high-pressure water. Unlike the other jetting zone, in this zones, the jet used is more than one, and are arranged side by side. This ensures that the bottles are well cleaned because of the multiple jetting bars that are present. After undergoing a series of freshwater jetting, the bottles will be dipped in another constant running freshwater tank. This will also ensure that the bottles are further cleaned with fresh water. After undergoing another freshwater cleaning, the bottle will undergo another set of freshwater jetting before it will come out at the discharge of the machine.
So the step involves our water jetting, bottle soaking, caustic washing, and freshwater cleaning.
Yes. Now let's look at how water are conserved. At the final treatment stage, the water used for the cleaning process is known as freshwater. The water is coming from the treatment facilities at the utilities. This clean water is used during the post-water treatment to clean and rinse the bottle after the bottles comes out of the caustic zone. Now, instead of dumping the water will be channeled back to the washer. The zones where this water are used is the bottle pre-soak zone and the first jetting bar. This is usually within the first half of the washer. Of course, because the bottles at this zones is very dirty, and it also prepared before the caustic cleaning, then the water used is of less importance.
Impressive, because at the first half of the washer is where the dirty lies. And basically, the bottles are prepared before they will enter caustic.
Yes. The water usage will be well conserved as a result. Let's dive into the engineering part. There is a sensor that detects non-align bottles. In a situation where the bottles does not align with the slot of the carriers, the bottle will fall off and intercepts the beam of the sensor, and as such, the machine will stop. Let's also look at the chain that moves the carriers. Of course, we know that chain tends to expand and contracts. In a situation where the chain contracts or there is a jam, the torque will increase on the motor that is driving the chains. So in order to prevent further damage to equipment, machine designer usually put a device which is known as torque limiter. The torque require has been preset to a certain value that is safe for the equipment and the material of the chain itself. In a situation where the torque exceeds its limits, the device will send a 24 volts to the PLC and the machine will stop. now in a situation where the chain expands. Then the generated torque will not be high and the machine will not trip as a result. However, one of the ways in which machine designer has been able to deal with this was the use of an encoder. Encoder are attached to each of the motors. The encoders are preset to a certain value. Now, because we are having a saggy chain, the encoder of the motor will move in such a way that the preset values will be exceeded. Again, because the value set has been exceeded, the machine will stop.
Perfect. When the chain sags, the machine will stop. Likewise, when the chain contracts, the machine will also stop. This is used to prevent damage to machinery. Interesting.
Now let me test your brain a little bit. What do you think will be done to a saggy chain?
There will be a need to reduce the chains, which is to basically remove some links.
How about if it is tensioned?
We will then need to add a link or two.
You are right to some extent. Usually, the machine comes with a mechanical adjustment that can be adjusted at interval. Finally, let's look at how temperature and fluids levels are regulated. To begin with, the machine is designed in such a way that, if the required temperature and fills level are not attained, the machine will not start. Transmitter ensures that the required temperature and level are met at all times, most especially temperatures. We all know that temperature difference should not be more than 20 degrees. Anything less or more will lead to thermal shock. So during commissioning, the receipt of the machine is developed to meet the 20 degrees difference. One thing worth noting is that this is not cast in stone. There are some instances that it will be more or less than that. Now let it sink. We all know that the bottles at infeed are at room temperature of 35 to 38 degrees. So the temperature of the first jetting zone will be 38 degrees. While pre-soak will be 45 degrees. The difference between 38 and 50 is not up to 20 degrees, while in the caustic bath, the temperature is usually between 60 to 65 degrees. Again, the temperature difference is not up to 20 degrees. In the second caustic zone, the temperature is between 75 and 82 degrees. The temperature difference is still not up to 20 degrees. While at the third caustic bath, the temperature is between 60 to 65 degrees. At the post-treatment zone, which is basically where the bottle will be washed with fresh water, the temperature is between 50 and 45 degrees. While at the final jetting zone, the temperature is at room temperature of between 40 and 35 degrees. As we can see throughout the bottle washing machine, the temperature should look like this graph. It is of great importance that our transmitter must be functioning properly. Otherwise, there will be problems. The most common problem is bottle cracked and weather bottles. If you want to learn more about transmitters, kindly check one of our series on that. A details explanation was made coupled with practical examples. Now let's do a quick recap. We started looking at bottle washer operation. From there we look at how water usage are minimized. And we also look at the engineering behind this wonderful machine, which is the use of encoders and torque monitoring device to monitor the chains as it moves along. Finally, we ended off by looking at transmitter. Their roles in keeping the temperature of the bottle washing machine were discussed extensively. Hope you have learned something new today. See you in the next one.